Hi, Belfast. This is Kelly at the Inner Space Center.
Hi, Kelly. How are you doing today?
I'm great, thank you. How's everyone there?
We're doing really well. We've had some people from Portugal through this afternoon, and we have a small audience here from England.
Awesome.
So,
yeah, we'll get started. So we have a fun-filled program for you today where we will discuss what we do here at the Ocean Exploration Trust and aboard our exploration vessel, the EV Nautilus. We'll also talk about some of the discoveries we've made this season, as well as get the chance to go live to members of the Corps of Exploration on board the EV Nautilus right now. But to start off the program, we have a short video to talk about what it is in the Nautilus Exploration Program.
We call our planet Earth, but 71% of it is covered by water. The deep oceans have captured human imagination since the dawn of civilization. We've explored its surface, even observed it from the moon. Now, with today's technologies of unmanned vehicles and telepresence, we can explore the deepest regions of our great oceans for the first time. Led by pioneering explorer Dr. Robert Ballard, the Corps of Exploration aboard the EV Nautilus are working to solve the mysteries of the deep. You can join them as they explore the unknown. The largest mountain ranges on our planet, and more volcanoes than are on the land. Plus, artifacts that tell the story of human civilization and creatures like nothing we have seen before. Now, we can all join the Corps of Exploration live on this great voyage of exploration.
Welcome back.
Hey, Kelly. We understand that Nautilus has some very high-tech tools for conducting exploration programs. Can you give us an idea of what some of those tools are?
Absolutely. So first is our ship, the EV Nautilus. She's 211 feet long and can hold up to 48 people, staying out to sea for 3 weeks or more. Mounted on the hull of the ship, or the bottom of the ship, is our multi-beam sonar mapping system. Now, this sonar uses an array of sound waves to make detailed maps of the seafloor. Now, so little of our ocean has actually been mapped, with this multi-beam mapping system, we're able to make these maps of the seafloor while moving the Nautilus at almost full speed of 11 knots. But after we've mapped an area, we need to use different tools to get a closer look. We use remotely operated vehicles, or ROVs, called Hercules and Argus, unlike manned submersibles. Now, these ROVs are equipped with high-definition cameras, really bright lights, and are connected back up to the ship by a long fiber optic cable where pilots in the control van or the command center are able to move them around. Now, Hercules has two manipulator arms, so the scientists in the control van are able to take samples and conduct experiments. ROVs provide an advantage of being able to stay down on the seafloor for however long we need them to, unlike human-occupied submersibles. We can share all of our discoveries live with another help of technology called telepresence. Now, this telepresence, it works by connecting Nautilus to shore via a stabilized satellite system, and then we can stream all of that data that we see from the seafloor and even data we collect live 24/7 through the internet. And that way, everyone all over the world is able to follow us and be a part of the exploration. Last and most important is our team that we call the Corps of Exploration. And our Corps comes from all over the world, bringing different expertise to the ship every time they come out. But now we're going to jump into the 2015 season, and to give us more of an update on what's been going on, we're going to bring on Brian and Katie, and they can give you an update and answer any questions that you have.
Hello, Belfast.
Hello.
We are live from the EV Nautilus, and we're actually in Galveston. We were just in port about a day ago, and we just finished our eco gig and cold seeps leg. And what we were doing in our eco gig is we were looking for the effects of the deep water horizon oil spill that happened quite a few years ago. And we were looking and revisiting coral sites to see if the coral had continued to grow, die off, or if there'd really been any change. And we really noticed quite a few things about some of the coral that had been there. The ones that were most affected and were saturated with the most oil, unfortunately, still aren't doing well, while some of the other ones that had less oil are actually starting to come back. The cold seeps leg, we were actually investigating brine rivers and brine pools, and we were taking a look at the symbiotes, the bacteria that live inside the mussels and corals that actually do a process called chemosynthesis, so they take the sulfides, the methane, and oil that actually naturally seep up from the bottom of the ocean, and they actually use it to provide food for the organism, as well as, in turn, the rest of the food chain. So at this time, we wanted to open up the questions to you all, see if you had any.
Hi, Brian. Hi, Katie. Thanks for that. Would anyone here like to ask a question of Katie and Brian?
Hi.
Hi.
That's a great question. Phil would like to know what exactly a brine pool is, please.
Excellent. A brine pool is kind of what it sounds like. It's actually a pool at the bottom of the ocean, and that pool is actually formed by salt and a large amount of salt pooling up from the tectonic plates underneath and deposits that were formed thousands upon thousands and thousands of years ago. And because it's so salty, it's much more dense than the water around it, so it actually forms what appears to be a pool, or in some cases a river, at the bottom of the ocean. And it's actually so salty that a lot of creatures that survive off of it have to stay right as close to the edge as they possibly can with the other things and chemicals that are seeping up, but if they actually fall into it or get too close, it actually will kill them. Very few creatures can live in there besides very specialized bacteria.
Wow, that's pretty cool. We're seeing some fantastic footage. Does that answer your question, Phil? Excellent. Anyone else like to ask a question? Oh, we've got a tough crowd. They're all very shy.
Well, if you haven't had an opportunity already, really check out the Brian Pool's investigation we had from a few days ago, where we were actually following up a canyon, and there were quite a few Brian River, and then what looked like an infinity pool of brine. And it was really amazing with the different type of bacterial mats that were around the edge that were living off of that, as well as a lot of the crabs and some of the grazers that come to feed on some of those bacteria and microbes.
Super. Thanks. We do have a couple of questions coming now.
Any more questions?
I just wanted to ask whether you ever go down in person, right, or whether these remote boat things go down on their own. Do you ever dive down yourselves with a diving suit?
We don't dive down ourselves. We have Hercules and Argus, and as Kelly was saying earlier, because they're remote-operated vehicles, it really helps us with our scientific exploration. We can't go down that deep, and if you have humans that are inside of those submersibles, it makes it much more difficult because you have to take into account human survival and the amount of time it takes just to get to the bottom as well as come back up. And with the ROVs, we're able to have them in the water. They're tethered to the ship and powered to the ship and work 24/7. And that way we can continue to rotate through. And I have 4 hours on, 8 hours off, and so does Katie. And we're able to continue and dive for all the way up to, I believe, 3 days is our longest dive. Katie, do you want to tell them how the ROVs work together?
Sure. So as Brian mentioned, we have the ROVs tethered to the ship. The tether connected to the ship is connected to Argus, and then there's a tether between Argus and Hercules. And we have that system set up so that Argus can absorb a lot of the tension coming from the surface. So we have a lot of wave action on the surface, and our ship moves around a lot, and Argus is able to absorb all of that energy so that Hercules can explore without being disturbed and have a much smoother ride. And so that allows us to have a more controlled dive.
Super. Any other questions?
More about the chemosynthesis, was it?
Great question. Can you tell us a little bit more about how chemosynthesis works?
That's an excellent question. Chemosynthesis works kind of similar to photosynthesis in the fact that instead of sunlight, essentially you have sulfides that are pulled up, and the bacteria have special organelles inside of it that actually use and process that to run return sulfides back actually into the environment, as well as actually use that process to create food energy for them.
Super. Thank you. Any other questions? Anything at all? That's a great question. Do the bright lights have any effect on the creatures that live in the dark normally?
That is a great question. There are quite a few organisms down there that have something called bioluminescence. So those organisms actually have their own lights, and that's typically achieved through another form of symbiotic bacteria living inside of them. But often because they're not used to the lights and we are so loud, we put a little GoPro in and we can actually see and hear our launch as we go. Most of the creatures kind of stay away from us just because it's probably like an alien ship coming to them. But it's a very normal world for them of darkness and really constant conditions, because the bottom of the ocean is really quite far and away the most common ecosystem on the planet, just because the oceans cover so much of our planet that a lot of them stay away from us, or at least as much as they possibly can. But occasionally we actually do get lucky, and while we go to investigate nature, nature comes to investigate us. About a month ago, we had a sperm whale on one of our descents that came down, and we could see it. He got really close to Hercules, kind of gave us a bit of a bump, really gentle, and you could see him as he kind of swam around and actually checked out with the left eye, and then swam around, checked us out from the right eye, and investigated us. So it was kind of a really cool role reversal.
That's super. Anyone else? Oh, that's a great question. How deep are the oil reefs that the corals... try that again. How deep are the coral reefs which the oil is affecting?
So in the Gulf of Mexico, it's shallow compared to what many of you would think with the Pacific. It's about 1,000 to 1,400 meters for most of our depths here in the Gulf of Mexico. So we find most of our things there. As we move forward with our next leg, we're going to be in the Gulf of Mexico again. Mm-hmm. And then we'll actually be going through the Panama Canal and up the Pacific towards the Galapagos. And we'll be doing some research there on the hydrothermal vents. And Katie, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think we're going to be about 3,000 meters deep there.
In the Galapagos, yeah, about 3,000.
Excellent. Any other questions? Okay, what are you studying right now?
Katie, do you want to talk about that?
Yeah, sure. So, I mean, right now we're in port, so we're not doing too much. But for the next leg, we're going to be continuing to study some brine pools and brine rivers and try and do a little more exploration there. And hopefully if we find mussel beds, we'll be collecting some more samples to send back to some of the scientists that were on board for our last leg. And hopefully one of my favorite parts coming up, we'll be diving on a shipwreck, which will be pretty exciting. It's one that hasn't been explored before. So if weather permitting, we'll be going out and diving down to kind of see what's down there and what remains of that shipwreck. So I'm really excited for that.
We get nice sonar mapping, and occasionally we get targets about potential shipwrecks in the area that haven't been explored before, and this is one that we're really hoping turns out to be a shipwreck and something really cool. Katie will be on board and be able to see it hopefully firsthand.
I will.
Excellent. And do you have an estimated date of departure from port?
We are hoping to leave tomorrow night or early Friday morning, depending on how the rest of the crew coming on and off goes.
When we came into port, we've been Excellent. Doing some modifications to our winch as well as our cable to make sure that we're ready for some of our deeper dives. So we send out some materials, we get some materials in. So depending on shipping rates and how long it takes to get some of those things, kind of depends on when we get to ship out, but hopefully soon.
Excellent. And does anyone have a last question for the guys? Oh, great question. How do you fund the expeditions?
The expedition is funded by a lot of partnerships, as a matter of fact. We have both corporate and private donors that donate, and Dr. Ballard goes around and continues to support and advertise and share the work that the EV Nautilus is doing, because this is kind of, it's not a common theme. When we think of the immediacy of the internet, you can think that you can see and hear and find out just about anything, but oftentimes scientific discoveries are something that are read about in textbooks or read about in articles that were written 2, 3, 4 months or when the paper comes out. But the amazing part of it, with the joy of the private donors and what they've been able to afford to us, we're able to have this telepresence. So we are in Galveston, Texas, on a ship talking to you from almost across the world, which is pretty amazing. So when we dive, through the generosity of our donors, we're able to share that experience with you as it happens. It's really cool when you're able to see and hear the reaction of the scientists and everyone in the control van, but we're very thankful to our sponsors.
That's excellent. Thanks, guys. Do we have time for one more question?
I think we do.
Yeah.
Could you maybe Excellent. Could you maybe tell us a little bit about what it's like to stay on board Nautilus and how long you're on for each of the expedition legs?
It really depends on your role. I'm a science communication fellow, so I'm actually a educator. I teach 5th and 6th grade math and science, and I have my own STEM program there at school. And I'm here so I can share with communities all across the world through telepresence such as this, as well as being on Science Party Line when you're watching us dive, and my students back at home to come back and share all the amazing work that Nautilus is doing. So I'm on here for about 10 days, and Katie's an intern, has been here a bit longer. Katie, can you?
Yeah, I came on board end of April, and I'm going to be here until May 20th or 21st. And I'm a science intern. So I go to Vanderbilt University, so it's been a really cool opportunity I've never been out to sea before. And I'm really here, I'm really interested in getting into deep sea research and marine biology. So this has been a great opportunity for me to learn a bit more about the field. I've gotten to work with a lot of really cool scientists and interact with a lot of individuals on board who I would never have the chance to meet otherwise. So it's been an amazing experience for me, and I've really enjoyed my time on board.
The ship really kind of works as a well-oiled machine. We have our crew, as well as the science crew, data team, video team, science communication fellows, and with our rotating shift of 4 hours on, 8 hours off, we're always able to have somebody there ready and raring to go, especially if we have a long dive. So you go to the berthing area, and you go to your room, and you might have someone sleeping, and someone starting to get up because their shift is coming up and yours has just ended. And we get 3 square meals a day, and they're always cooked very well. So we have just about anything that you could want, as far as if you're a vegetarian, pescatarian, if you really enjoy all types of different varieties of meat. We have just about everything we need, and it's really really easy way to function once you get used to the rocking back and forth occasionally in seas. But that's about all the time we have now for questions. At this time, we're going to throw it back to Kelly in the Inner Space Center. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys.
Thanks, Belfast. I do have to get back to work, but we have one last video to show you, a message from Dr. Robert Ballard.
Today, more than ever, we're coming to realize how precious our oceans are and how interconnected all of us on planet Earth have become. Deep ocean exploration has become vital to our planet's future. Thanks to telepresence and the internet, you can join Dr. Ballard and the Corps of Exploration aboard EV Nautilus 24 hours a day as they go where no person has gone before.
I really enjoy sharing my experiences, and I can't think of anything better than having you come with me and let you experience that as well. And now we have the technology that I don't have to wait to come home and tell you. You can come aboard the ship and be there at that moment and not read about it, but has said, I was there.
Thanks again for joining us today. If you have any other questions and want to follow along for the rest of the season, you can go to nautiluslive.org. And for dive alerts and updates, you can check out our Facebook and Twitter page. Thank you.
Thanks, Kelly. Bye-bye.